The next item of business is the second stage of the Civil Service (brackets Special Advisors, brackets Amendment) Bill. I call Mr. Jim Allister to move the second stage of the Civil Service Special Advisors (brackets Amendment) brackets Bill and open the debate on the bill.
Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I move that the second stage of the Civil Service Special Advisors Amendment Bill be agreed. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, in other circumstances, a bill such as this would not be necessary. But the absence of self-restraint, self-control and self-regulation makes this bill essential. Because over recent times, the provision for and the remuneration of special advisers has got wholly out of control. I say that in the context of the benchmarks created by the provision for special advisers in the other devolved regions of the United Kingdom. We are the smallest of the devolved regions, and yet we have 19 special advisers. Wales, with its greater population, has 8, sometimes 9, but essentially 8 special advisers. Scotland has 14. Not only that, we pay them sums of money excessively out of kilter with that applicable elsewhere in the devolved regions. In Northern Ireland, the latest figures produced show that last year our 19 special advisers cost the taxpayer £2,016,362. That's an average cost of £106,000 per special advisor. That's what the average package per special advisor costs. The figures for 13-14 available for both Scotland and Wales paint a very different picture. They show that in Wales, the average costs in 13-14 of their special advisers, in contrast to our £100,000 plus, was £58,500 each. Rising the following year, because of an increase in number, which seemed to have been temporary, to 69,000. Still well shy of the £100,000 plus cost in Northern Ireland. In Scotland, with its 14 special advisers, the average cost is £73,000. Now, what is it about special advisers in Northern Ireland that makes them so special that they have to be paid and cost the taxpayer in excess of £100,000, currently £106,000 a year, in contrast to £50,000, £60,000, £70,000 in the other devolved regions? Yes, there is a role for special advisers. And the more specialist they are, and some aren't, the more that role perhaps is to be valued. But there's something seriously wrong when within this jurisdiction we are overpaying in terms of the benchmark which exists elsewhere. And that has been contributed to by deliberate political action in Northern Ireland. Because freedom of information, when finally answered after 2 years, indicated that in 2011, at the start of this mandate, there was a deliberate political decision to raise phenomenally the top line of special advisers. Special advisers in Northern Ireland, supposedly in financial terms, fall under two bands, Band A and Band B. Band A embraces a salary range between £37,000 and £53,000 a year. Band B embraces a salary range between £59,000 and £92,000 a year. It evolved to £92,000 a year because of a political decision by the First Minister and the Finance Minister at the start of this mandate in July 2011, when it rocketed from just over 80,000 to 90,000. And that at a time, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, when senior civil servants and special advisers are civil servants, when senior civil servants were subject to pay freeze, and at the very time when senior civil servants were subject to pay freeze, a political decision was taken by the Finance Minister to break that as far as this brand of civil servants was concerned, and to give them a 10% increase, and to take them to the dizzy heights where they now are today. And the freedom of information is very interesting, because it reveals that it was indeed the First Minister, because a memorandum written by the Department's Director of Corporate Human Resources at the time indicates that in May 2011, the Minister had been asked by the First Minister how the maximum for the upper pay band for civil servants could be increased. That document from the Director of Corporate Human Resources advised that pay rates for SPADs were linked to changes in civil service pay bands and were based on the average pay increase agreed for civil servants. And that civil servant who wrote this document then went on to say, "I made clear that these arrangements had been agreed by the Northern Ireland Executive in May 2007. I pointed out that senior civil service pay had been frozen for 2 years, and there was to be no increase either in the senior civil service pay reference points or in the base pay between April 10 and March 2012. So the situation was that back in 2007, it was agreed by the executive that any pay increase for special advisers would be in line with the arrangements applicable to senior civil servants. But come May 2011, the First Minister intervenes to see with the Finance Minister how, despite that, pay increases could be obtained. And the documentation on the FOI goes on to record the fact that on the 14th of July that year, another civil servant, having been told the Minister was minded to give the phenomenal increase, to break the pay freeze as far as these civil servants were concerned. That civil servant wrote in a memo, I indicated I had serious reservations about this particular issue, considered that the minister should reconsider, given the decision taken by the executive and the recent events surrounding special advisers, and wanted the minister to reflect on the matter. The civil servant added that nothing could happen because it was a holiday time, and I wanted to reflect on this issue as I considered that it conflicted with the code of ethics which I was required to follow. There's a senior civil servant advising the minister that what they were being asked to sign off for special advisers, potentially conflicted with their own civil service code of ethics, and urging the minister to reconsider. But did he? No. In July, the height of the holiday season, 2011, the minister slipped through an increase, a top-line increase, for special advisers from over £80,000 to £90,000 a year. Breached the attachment of increases to senior civil service increases. And one of the purposes of this bill is to protect against further flagrant breach again of that nature, and to bring a very defined legislative attachment between this pay of this brand of civil servant, special advisers, and other senior civil servants. And of course, once the salary band had been increased to £90,000, events took their natural course. And lo and behold, we discover that today, well, until Ms. Pengelly resigned as the special advisers, the First Minister's three special advisers were all on the 92,000 top line of Band B. Indeed, the evolution from 2011 to 2015 is most interesting, because in the first days of this Assembly, the 2007 one and the 2011 one, as you would expect, there was a spread of special advisers across Band A, the lower band, and Band B, the higher band. But by last year, every single one of the 19 special advisers, surprise, surprise, were on Band B. No one left on Band A whatsoever. And indeed, until the DOE minister changed his special advisor, I think it was in July 14, for the first time, did a special advisor again fall within Band A. So it is quite clear, and should be clear to this House, that the idea that this matter can be left to self-restraint and self-control is a myth. That every opportunity has been taken to exploit this situation and to cream off from the taxpayer the maximum by some in respect of special advisers' remuneration. And what of the number of special advisers? 19 compared to 8 in Wales, compared to 14 in Scotland. Indeed, the Office of the Joint First Ministers has the same total number of special advisers, 8, as the whole of the Welsh Government. That's how preposterous and how out of hand this matter has got. And so this bill proposes that we should restrict there being no self-restraint. We should restrict the number of special advisers in the office of First and Deputy First Minister. And the formula suggested, and I'm not wedded to this formula whatsoever, but the formula suggested is that the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister each have presently three, that should be reduced to one, and then the junior ministers have one. Now, the junior ministers historically did not have special advisers. That was a creation of 2007, when it was decided to add to the special advisers and to give the junior ministers in OFM, DFM, a special adviser each. Before that, it was three for the First Minister, three for the Deputy First Minister, a total of six. By that method, it became eight. My ambition and suggestion in this bill is to reduce it to four. Now, whether that is done, as the bill presently stands, by reducing the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister to one each, and the Junior Minister to one each, or whether it's done by reducing them to two each, the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister, and taking away the provision, which apparently wasn't needed before 2007, of the junior ministers having a special advisor. I don't really have a strong view about that. I think it can be done either way. But it is preposterous that the office First and Deputy First Minister needs the same number of special advisers as the entire Welsh Government and pays them something like 50% more than they're paid in Wales. Even the whole United Kingdom government, which is a government dealing with the full range of governmental issues, international issues, the average cost of a special advisor in Westminster is more than £20,000 less than the average cost in Northern Ireland. On the latest figures, a special advisor in Westminster, their package costs £83,500. In Northern Ireland, a special advisor's package costs £106,000. So whether you make the comparison, which I think is the most relevant comparison, with the other devolved institutions, or you make it even with the national government and take upon yourself all the pretensions of such a comparison, it is totally out of kilter. And since it has got there by deliberate political meddling in the setting of the bands to push them ever higher and to decouple them from the natural progression of any increases that come within senior civil service pay bands. Since it has been that political meddling which has ignited the increase, then I'm saying to this House that this House should get a grip on this thing and should itself legislate to put a ceiling on the runaway costs of special advisers. And I'm suggesting that we link them properly and permanently to the relevant pay scale of a relevant senior civil servant. And I suggest that that would more than adequately be met by attaching special advisers' pay to the pay scale applicable to assistant secretaries, grade fives in our civil service. And what is that pay scale? Well, it currently is a range of £65,422, maxing out at £78,275. So a range between £65,000 and £78,000. Now, I'm not saying, and this bill does not say, that that should be the pay of every special advisor. I anticipate retaining Band A and Band B, remind you that Band A starts at £37,000. But what this legislation would do, it would say that in every case, special advisers are capped at the grade 5 senior civil service pay rank. In other words, no one could earn more than £78,000 as a special advisor, which still keeps them handsomely ahead of what their counterparts are paid in Wales or in Scotland. So it's not a matter of being mean to the Northern Ireland special advisers. This legislation is still generous to them, but generous to them in a way which restores some element of accountability in pay structures, removes the potential for political meddling, such as we saw in 2011, in the massaging of those pay structures, and puts us on something of a par with what you would expect elsewhere. So this bill tackles the number of special advisers, which of course, if there is the reformulation of departments, will naturally fall to whatever the number of, in consequence of a fall in the number of departments, but that doesn't address the primary irritant in terms of the common sense approach to this, of O of M, DFM being oversubscribed in terms of special advisers. So this bill seeks to address that. It seeks to bring some reasonable measure to the pay issues. And the third thing that this bill does, since special advisers are civil servants, it addresses the problem which arose on foot of the Red Sky investigation, where an independent fact-finding investigation by the Department of Finance and Personnel in respect of the DSD Special Advisor, Mr. Brimstone, recommended that there should be a disciplinary process in respect of him. And what happened? His minister, who appointed him, quashed it, stepped in, said, we don't need that. There'll be no investigation. It is not the purpose of a minister to determine when and when there should not be a civil service disciplinary process. Civil servants are civil servants, and it is for the processes of the civil service to apply to them, and to apply to them all. And special advisers cannot expect to benefit from all the benefits that come from being a civil servant, the pension scheme, all of that, but dodge and evade the disciplinary possibilities which come as to their conduct. So this bill, on that third limb, would make it abundantly clear that the normal disciplinary processes of the civil service would also apply to these civil servants, special advisers, and expressly prohibit any ministerial meddling in that. And that, I think, is right. I suggest to the House that because of the failure to self-restrain in all these matters, that legislation is now necessary on this matter, and that what this bill contains is a measured response to the situation. It's not punitive, it is measured, I respectfully suggest, and I trust in that basis it will find favour with the House.
I call the chairperson of the Finance and Personnel Committee, Mr. Dathi Mackay.
Can I start by thanking the member for outlining the general principles of the bill and his rationale for bringing forward the proposed legislation. I also welcome the opportunity to contribute to this debate on behalf of the committee, which will presumably be scrutinising the provisions of the bill should it pass second stage here today. I note, Prevost concurred the main provisions of the bill as outlined by Mr. Alistair, firstly, to ensure that special advisers are subject to the Civil Service Disciplinary Code, secondly, to limit the remuneration to the Senior Civil Service Grade 5 scale, currently £65,422 to £78,275, and thirdly, to reduce the number of special advisers or SPADs in OFM DFM from 8 to 4. Whilst I was unable to attend last week's committee meeting, I understand that members received a useful briefing from the member, which provided an initial opportunity to tease out the policy intentions of the bill and related issues. I also noted the significant media interest in the discussion. If I may, I will summarise and reflect on some of the main points covered at last week's session, which perhaps will help inform today's debate. At the meeting, the proposer of the bill set out the policy context in terms of the current special adviser arrangements and the associated costs, especially during this time of austerity. He pointed to the potential for the bill to make modest but significant savings to the public purse. Members were advised that over 98% of the 150 respondents to the policy consultation were in favour of the bill. However, it was noted that the responses were from individuals as opposed to representative groups, and some members also queried the extent of information provided in the consultation document. In terms of the absence of views from representative groups and other bodies, I can advise that members subsequently agreed that, again subject to the bill passing second stage, written and oral evidence will be sought from key stakeholders, including the Department of Finance and Personnel, the Trade Unions, the Equality Commission and the Human Rights Commission. I would also anticipate that the committee will issue a wider call for evidence, which will be published on the commencement of the committee stage. A further issue which the committee explored with Mr. Alistair was in terms of the rationale for setting the special advisor's pay scale at the level of NICS Grade 5. I would expect that members will wish to give further consideration to the setting of this particular scale and associated pay progression. The job evaluation used a grade, a special advisor post, as well as the logistics of setting the salary. Members may also wish to explore further the mechanism for agreeing the starting point for a special advisor and if this should change in the future. Members are also keen to explore the extent to which the position of the special advisers here can be compared with other devolved administrations, including in terms of other multi-party governments. In particular, the question was raised at the committee as to whether additional skill sets and requirements arise from the particular political divisions and complexities of our power-sharing arrangements here, including in terms of the nature and extent of negotiations which are undertaken and always ongoing, obviously. A further question which was raised during the session was around how we can ensure that the right calibre of person is attracted to the specialist advisor post and that the salary is commensurate with their level of skills and qualifications. Reference was made, for example, to the role of the special advisor in the Department of Health, Social Services and Public Safety. There was also some discussion on the possibility of including a speciality clause in the bill. This would enable particular professional requirements for SPADs in given departments to be defined, and as regards what the remuneration may be in such cases. Other points discussed during the session with Mr. Alistair included the impact of the restructuring of government departments, both on the number and role of special advisers, the fact that the provisions of the bill do not take effect until the beginning of the next parliamentary mandate, and that there will be no issues with contractual obligations or retrospective application, and whether the civil service disciplinary procedures will need to be amended either via the bill or administratively in order to enable their application to special advisers. Subject to this second stage being agreed, the committee will want to give detailed consideration to the provisions of the bill. Whilst this will take place against an already very heavy work programme, I'm sure that the committee will do its very best to ensure that it concludes its deliberations within a reasonable time frame. And to conclude the pre-vast concour, I believe that the evidence session which the committee had last week with Mr Alistair was useful in providing an initial opportunity for members to explore the principles of this bill and the related considerations. Today's debate offers a further opportunity, and I look forward to hearing the contributions of members in that regard.
Well, Mr Gordon Lyons.
Thank you, Mr Principal Deputy Speaker. I welcome the opportunity to put on record the views of my party in relation to this bill. I'm speaking on this subject further to Mr Alistair's appearance before the DFP committee last week. Mr Principal Deputy Speaker, were I to bring a private member's bill to this Assembly, I would seek to maximise opportunity for support. I would speak to other parties, listen to concerns, and try to find a way for my original objectives to be incorporated into a bill that could gain the support of this House. The lack of consultation, the lack of cooperation with other parties, along with the words and the tone of Mr Alistair this morning, suggests that this bill is more of an opportunity for him to grandstand rather than provide better government for Northern Ireland. In my opinion, he should have followed the example that was set by the member for South Down, Mr McAllister, in how to consult with good grace in relation to private members' bills. This bill is short, touching on three main issues. However, I believe that each of the three main issues within this bill has its weaknesses, and I want to address those in concern. The first one is in relation to discipline, and the bill completely removes the power of the ministers in these matters. The bill ignores the fact that a special advisor is a temporary political appointee who's appointed by the minister and supports the minister in his or her duties in a way that permanent civil servants cannot. To remove the minister from such decisions is not only out of step with the practice in the rest of the UK, but it also seems illogical that the minister would not have authority in these matters. Secondly, the bill attempts to change pay bans for for special advisers by linking it to the same pay scale as an assistant secretary, grade 5 in the civil service. However, there seems to be no justification as to why it is tied to this level. Now, Mr Alistair has mentioned that grade 5 would be the level on which some special advisers would be communicating with people in the Civil Service Act, but I don't think that that is an appropriate way in which to tie it. And Mr Alistair was pressed on this a couple of times within the committee, and I do not believe that a proper justification has been given. What are the duties required in that job? What are the necessary skills that are comparable to grade 5 in the civil service? So we are not arguing that the pay levels of special advisers should not be reviewed. However, the setting of pay scales has always been a matter for the executive and the minister for finance, and I don't believe that they should be specified in legislation. Finally, the bill seeks to cut the number of special advisers. Now, Mr Alistair has stated today, and when he was before the committee, that he believes that the cost of special advisers is too high, that government is too big, and that we need to cut down. And I couldn't agree more. We do need to do all of those things. And that's why I am pleased that my party has led the way on reform of government in Northern Ireland. And as a result, we are going to be cutting the number of departments next year from 12 to 9. And as a result of that, we will have at least three fewer special advisers. In addition, we're also going to be cutting the number of MLAs by the 2021 election. Now, I would prefer that that would happen sooner. I would prefer that it were to happen next year. I think 108 is too many. I don't think we need that many. So we're more than happy for that to be brought forward if other parties agree. But let's take these in the whole. All of these different reforms, cutting departments, cutting SPADs, cutting the number of MLAs, these are significant reforms which will help to tackle the concerns that many people have about the cost and size of government in Northern Ireland. However, the problem with this bill is that it seeks to cut the number of special advisers in OFM, DFM, without taking into account the current discussions that are ongoing in relation to the size and functions of the new executive office. I believe it would be inconceivable that the number of ministers and special advisers in that new department would not be up for discussion as a result of the removal of functions from that new executive office to other departments. To change in legislation and specify the number of special advisers that a department should have, while those discussions are ongoing, would tie the hands of the executive, and it is much more preferable, in my opinion, that we work out what the functions and responsibilities of that department would be, and then decide on what support is needed for ministers. Much has been made of the comparison between Northern Ireland and Scotland and Wales as other devolved nations within the kingdom. And in my opinion, we can't compare them. Scotland and Wales are one-party governments. And I'm sure members will have read the written evidence that was submitted to the House of Commons Public Administration Select Committee on Political Special Advisers when they held their inquiry at Westminster. And the evidence that is there is clear that the nature and the role of SPAD changes within a coalition government in comparison to a one-party government. And I think that just shows us that they're not, they cannot be directly compared. And similar statistics actually from New Zealand, which has operated with multi-party governments over the last number of years, would show the same thing. So yes, there is a need for perhaps greater advice, as Mr. Alistair in fact indicated during his evidence to the DFP committee. So I want to be very, very clear, I'm not saying that OFM, DFM or the new executive office, as it will be called, should be protected from reductions in the number of SPADs, and it is very likely that we will see reductions there, but to cut to a single advisor for the ministers in those in that new department would not seem appropriate to me when you consider the difficulties and problems that exist in departments such as those. But even taking that into consideration and even understanding that there are differences between Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland, let's just consider Scotland for a short period, because, and I'm sure members will be familiar with the Research and Information Service pack that was provided for this debate, and if members were to read that, they would see that the First Minister of Scotland has six special advisers that answer only to her and are responsible only for her department. In addition, her Chief of Staff, Liz Lloyd, is also responsible to the First Minister and works the majority of her time for the First Minister, but she also works on a temporary basis for the Minister for Culture, Europe and External Affairs. So I argue there is a difference between Scotland and other devolved regions, or between Northern Ireland and other devolved regions such as Scotland, but what we have here very clear is even in a one-party government, there is a need and a requirement for special advisers. So I'm not saying that they should be protected in the new executive office. I'm saying let us just make a rational decision over what is needed and what is required in that department. So in summary, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, the bill changes the role of SPADs within the department in terms of the disciplinary procedure, and that would be to the detriment of the Minister and to the effective running of the department if they were to be brought in closer to line with the civil service. There is also no justification given for linking the pay of special advisers to grade 5 in the civil service. And finally, the bill ignores the reforms that are already taking place and that the number and the cost of SPADs are going to be cut. And Mr. Alistair made a point very clearly at the start of his presentation to the DFP committee that the reason for this bill was to cut down on the cost and the number of SPADs. And we say very clearly that's already taking place. That is happening by the reforms which have already been discussed and negotiated and agreed. So I'm very pleased that we can stand here towards the end of this Assembly term and say that we have gone farther than any other during this mandate than any other mandate in terms of reform of the Assembly and of the structures here. I want to see further reform. I hope that happens, but we have made good progress, and that should be welcomed by everyone in this chamber. So as a result of those issues and of what I have already said to the House, we make it clear that we will be opposing this bill. Thank you very much.
Mr. Dominic Bradley.
Iri and show her mighty nuggets, Tachiak, the Horch Dun Villa Shaw, Eichen Le Lasu Yenu, Fa August, Yisciplin Nagorlori Special. Thank you very much, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. I rise here today to support this bill at this second stage, albeit with some reservation or reservations. Mr. Alistair, is fast becoming the special advisor to the Assembly on special advisers, although he may not be rewarded by the same level of remuneration that is average for the existing special advisers. But nonetheless, the SDLP welcomes this bill and the areas which it seeks to probe and amend. Mr. Alistair did come to the Finance Committee last week, and he outlined the reasons behind this bill, them being the controversy surrounding the number, costs and disciplinary regime applicable to SPADs. And in the bill, Clause 1 aims to amend the Civil Service Special Advisers Act Northern Ireland to make special advisers subject to the prevailing civil service disciplinary process. And that would require the Code of Conduct to provide that special advisers are subject to the processes and the procedures of the disciplinary code operative in the Northern Ireland Civil Service. This would, in fact, as pointed out earlier, prevent ministers blocking attempts to discipline special advisers. And as Mr. Alistair himself pointed out, the genesis of this seems to be an incident which arose in the past in relation to the Red Sky affair. Special advisers are classified as temporary civil servants, and as such they are supposed to be subject to the NICS Code of Ethics and also a special advisor specific code of conduct. In relation to special advisors being subject to the civil service disciplinary proceedings, I did ask Mr. Alistair if there was any need to change or amend the disciplinary code which exists at the moment, in order that it include the work of SPADs. He thought that the previous code could still apply, and that my own view is that I would welcome the opportunity to explore this area in more detail, perhaps at the committee stage of the bill, with the advice of the head of human resources from the civil servant, or indeed the head of the civil service, because although SPADs or special advisers are classified as temporary civil servants, they have a different role to civil servants, and they are not the same. And we must ensure that that difference in role is reflected in the Civil Service Disciplinary Code in order to accommodate them. Clause 1 also requires the Code for Appointments to prescribe that special advisers must not be remunerated at the must not be remunerated at above the rate applicable to grade 5 civil servants, and that's between 65,000 rough more or less and approximately 78,000. Mr. Alistair pointed out that the collective current cost for special advisers is in excess of £2 million and that the average cost is around £103,000. That certainly is a high salary, and it's ironic that in some cases special advisers are paid more than the ministers they advise and they work for. And we are all led to believe that the buck stops with the minister, but with a salary of this magnitude, one wonders should it stop with the special advisor rather than the minister. It seems ridiculous that special advisers are being paid more than the heads of the departments, that is, the ministers. Question arose from the point of view of the comparisons made by Mr. Alistair between Northern Ireland and Scotland, Northern Ireland and Wales, and Northern Ireland and Whitehall. Some of the committee members believe that he was not comparing like with like. So once again, that's an area I think which can be explored in more detail with more evidence at the committee stage of the bill. But I do note that in the consultation carried out by Mr. Alistair, 98% of the respondents said that the salaries of SPADs should be reduced to bring them into line with what is paid in other devolved institutions. Although we have heard some aspersions cast on the consultation carried out by Mr. Alistair that the net was not carried, was not thrown widely enough, and that most of the respondents were indeed individuals, and that no public body or corporate bodies responded. So maybe that's something that Mr. Alistair would like to respond to when he sums up at the end of this debate. He did say, he did explain during the Finance Committee meeting that the reason he set the pay for special advisers at grade 5 of civil service pay scales. He did say that his rationale for that was that that was the level of civil servants with which special advisers engaged, and whether or not that should be the determining factor is something again which could be looked at in more detail. I did question Mr. Alistair at the committee as to the level of savings that would be made through the enactment of his bill, but he was unable, for obvious reasons, to give precise sums. But he did say that a substantial amount of money would be saved each year. When we look at the average cost of a special advisor at around £103,000, for that to be reduced to a maximum of £78,000, obviously there would be substantial savings. And at this time of austerity. We need to make all savings that we can do. Clause 2 of the bill seeks to amend the Civil Service Commissioner's order to reduce the number of special advisers within OFM-DFM from 8 to 4. Under the current system, each Minister of the Executive, including junior ministers, is entitled to make one appointment, but the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister can appoint 3 each. This again is higher than is the case in Scotland and Wales, where they have 14 and 8 special advisers respectively across all of the government. And even with the reduction of OFM SPADs from 8 to 4, we would still have more special advisers than Scotland and Wales. So in OFM-DFM, we have junior ministers to advise and support the First Minister and Deputy First Minister, and we also have SPADs to advise and support the junior ministers. That seems to be a little bit ridiculous. I note that during the consultation process, 98% of the respondents to this, the consultation on this bill agreed that the number of SPADs should be reduced. 92% said that it was reasonable to reduce the number in OFM-DFM from 8 to 4. Mr. Alistair, at the committee, was asked how he could be sure that the roles and responsibilities of SPADs in Scotland and Wales were comparable to those of SPADs in Northern Ireland, especially in relation to complexities arising out of political divisions here. His response to that was that the fact that 4 special advisers are afforded to the First Minister and Deputy First Minister more than allows for those special circumstances and possible complexities. The SDLP agree and have said before that there should be a reduction of special advisers, and we believe that 8 SPADs for a single department is extremely excessive. Mr. Alistair also was asked about how the restructuring in executive departments would impact on the need for special advisers. And he said that if the number of departments decreases, the number of special advisers will go down accordingly. So this would have an added impact on the cost reduction of special advisers. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, at this second stage of the bill, the SDLP is happy to support the bill in the knowledge that at committee stage we will have the opportunity to explore some of the issues that we have raised in more detail and in the context of evidence from a wider selection of individuals and public bodies than Mr. Alistair had access to. One of the points that I did raise with Mr. Alistair during the committee stage was that the nature of the speciality that these advisers lay claim to. And since his bill contains, obviously, the word special, should his bill not have reflected what degree of speciality special advisers should have? And he did reply to me that he is open to looking at any amendment which might seek to define speciality in relation to these advisers. So, a frio las concordia, igan winchisha, tame Sasta Gurfleme Lishna Namor Fwinchi Askrian Asin Villasha August Murdurt Ben Hanafian Be Jish Ogum Egan Egheman Kostje Narudisha Inuchu Nismina. So thank you very much, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. As I said, I look forward to the committee stage of the bill and to examining some of these issues in more detail. Go to Míle Maiogat. Thank you very much.
Oh, Mr. Leslie Cree.
Thank you very much, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. The difficulty always is at this stage that nearly everything has been said. But seeing I've written it out, I'm going to say it anyway. The bill, Mr. Alistair's bill, really is straightforward and very simple. Again, it's been referred to by many members. There are three really distinct clauses. The first one deals with special advisers. This is my order priority. That these advisers should be subject to the processes and procedures of the disciplinary code which applies to the civil service in Northern Ireland. The second one is remuneration, and that has been well ventilated here this morning. There is logic in having a cap. There is logic in having a scale. And therefore, I don't see any difficulty with that. The third point is reduction of the number of advisers in the office of the First and Deputy First Ministers. Following the Red Sky investigation, Mr. Alistair referred to it himself, the adviser was subject to a fact-finding independent investigation by the Department of Finance and Personnel. The Department recommended the instigation of disciplinary investigation. And again, as Mr. Alistair pointed out, the relevant minister was able to override the issue, and I think that that was wrong. Special advisers are civil servants and therefore should be amenable to the existing disciplinary code. We've heard a lot again about the numbers, been fairly well trotted over. 19 in Northern Ireland, costing £2 million at the last count, an average of 103,500 I've heard up to 106 been mentioned. Wales again with their cost of 58, only 8 SPADs, same number employed in the UFM-DFM. Scotland with 14 and their average earning 73,000. So the question is, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, why do we in Northern Ireland need so many special advisers? The 8 and OFM, DFM certainly have not improved the performance of that department. The third objective in the bill is to set this salary scale and cap to control the cost of special advisers. And again, as Mr. Alistair has pointed out, I believe this is necessary too, particularly in these difficult times, difficult financial times. You know, we've had this unilateral action been taken by the minister to upgrade the salaries I think, again, this is something that should not be at the whim of a minister. Much has been made of the necessary qualifications of advisers, and we had that again at the committee. The necessary qualifications, if any, and the contrast between those salaries which can be commanded in the private sector and those in the public sector. My view is that this is a red herring, as individuals decide on their own career structure, and the qualifications and job specifications of special advisers set out the terms for the respective posts. In 2011, we had the first, and I learn now it's only the first, but I've done the first and deputy, increasing their special advisers from 80 to 90 during that period of pay freeze, which certainly was not a very good example. It seems to me, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, that action does need to be taken to control the numbers and costs involved. And therefore, I'm satisfied to allow the bill to proceed to the next stage of the Ulster Unionist Party. Thank you.
I call Mrs. Judith Cochran.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, and on behalf of the Alliance Party, I welcome the opportunity to speak on the bill, which seeks to put in place stricter measures around the remuneration and accountability of special advisers, as well to amend the number of special advisers to be appointed by ministers. Others have already covered a number of the points, so I will try not to repeat them. also because I've got a very sore throat, I will keep my comments shorter. I support the principles of the bill, as any measure which seeks to improve transparency and efficiency when it comes to spending public money should be welcomed, especially as we are keen to try and make savings in other areas. And as others have already said, the bill essentially focuses on three key areas. Firstly, ensuring special advisers are subject to the processes and procedures of the disciplinary code which operates in the civil service. And given that SPAD is treated as a temporary civil servant, this would seem like a natural step. Secondly, the bill looks at the salaries of the special advisers and makes proposals to limit this. Currently, as others have said, SPAD can earn between 25% and 90% more than an MLA, and in and around the same figure as senior civil servants. And to some, this would appear to be excessive, given that they can be appointed without abiding by typical recruitment rules and the principles of merit, nor are they democratically elected. However, to others, they acknowledge the capabilities of many of the special advisers and argue that they work at a level that should attract current salary scales. I think this bill gives us a good opportunity to consider this issue, and I look forward to discussing this further in committee stage to ensure that fair and appropriate measures and remuneration guidelines are in place. Thirdly, then, the proposal about reducing the numbers of special advisers that exist in OFM DFM. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, we've said that there are currently 19 special advisers overall in the Assembly, and Clause 2 deals specifically with cutting the number in OFM DFM from 8 to 4. And again, I welcome the opportunity that the bill provides to consider this important issue, which on face value seems like we are way out of kilter with other devolved institutions. However, I do think that the current proposal seems quite a blunt tool, and I think that more could be done in this area. We could be more creative with it so that the bill actually becomes much more operationally effective. For example, in the past, I have proposed that junior ministers should perhaps be reallocated to the larger departments with a greater spend, such as health, and perhaps there's an opportunity to put in place stricter rules to ensure we have different levels of special advisers with varying salary scales and appropriate skills, to ensure that they're actually better utilised to help to deliver better public services, because that's what we're actually here for. So I look forward to exploring this issue also more in committee stage. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, in closing, I support the bill's passage today to committee stage, but I think that there is work to be done on it to make it a really effective, operationally effective bill. Thank you.
Mr. Raymond McCartney.
Thank you very much, Principal Deputy Speaker. I suppose in one respect there are some of the issues which is contained in this bill which does require some sort of public focus, and I suppose that's fair enough, but we don't believe that the legislation is the vehicle to do it. Indeed, in terms of reductions in salary, Dahi Mackay, the Chair, I already spoke on behalf of Sinn Féin on a number of occasions, has put the challenge out that perhaps there should be a 15% reduction across the board, and even the proposer of the bill, there was no reply from them. I suppose that is no surprise given that Sinn Féin is the people who proposed this. I even think in principle that this bill is an amendment to the Civil Service Bill of 2013, which we believe was a bad bill. It was a discriminatory bill. Indeed, it was a bill that, in our opinion, was vindictive and targeted, and that a Republican ex-prisoner who subsequently had leave that particular post. And we don't see this as in any way that materially different. I think, whereas there may be a popularity around this, Mr. Alistair is well known as an opponent of these institutions, and every opportunity which presents itself, he takes it to attack it. I even look at the consultation, and our point has been made. It's a very poor consultation document, even in terms of the disciplinary code. One single question, no explanation as to the need or the rationale for it. Indeed, he describes it to all our civil servants. SPADs, whatever you think about them, and people are entitled to their opinion, are not all our civil servants. The legislation is very clear. They are temporary civil servants. They're not recruited by civil servants. They don't go through the same procedures. Indeed, we would have difficulties with how the civil service recruits, because again, we believe it's discriminatory. And even putting someone into the realm of that disciplinary code, then they could create the situation where our people would be asked to leave their positions, and we certainly will not be in a position where we would ever support that. So I think in... Yeah,
can the member explain, in a time of austerity, why the member defends the significant increase in SPAD pay from the 80,000 cap to 93,000? Can you explain and justify that increase in pay way above an average wage?
I certainly couldn't, nor will I, but I think there has to be a discussion around that. But sometimes people can vote with their feet. We put forward a proposition that there should be a 15% reduction on all wages right across in times of austerity. Certainly from this party, we know, because in terms of our own salaries, we take the average industrial wage. So perhaps the first time they have done it, before Danny Kennedy had a left, if your SPAD had been on a different band, then you might have a different position. But this sort of idea of the whited sepulchre, all of a sudden consciences being pricked about particular things in the absence of doing something about it, I think will ring hollow with people. We will vote with our feet. If people want to make a voluntary contribution of a 15% reduction across the board, then Sinn Féin has already tabled that as part of a budget which people opposed. So I'll not be taking no lectures from the member on that particular thing. As I've said, there may be issues here that need some teasing out in the public domain. We don't think legislation is the proper thing for it. We don't think the motivation of the particular member is about the public good. It's more about attacking these institutions. He's on record of doing that. We have seen how he used the Special Advisors Bill in the past to attack particularly Republican ex-prisoners, and we will stand as the gatekeepers to ensure that doesn't happen in the future.
Call Mr. Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker, and I'd like to welcome the bill and again reiterate a point I made yesterday that it's good to see private members' bills coming forward in the absence of legislation coming forward from the executive. And we'd had a number of weeks where the sessions were finishing at 3:30 after ministerial questions, but certainly yesterday, due to Mr. McAllister's private member's bill, we had a full plenary, and I anticipate that will be the case today again because we have this business coming forward. So it's welcome that whilst the executive may be feeling that the Assembly and the role of the backbenchers is actually showing leadership and ensuring that this House continues to do the work that we're all paid to do. I welcome the bill, and I welcome in particular the proposal to bring SPADs under the Code of Conduct for Civil Servants. Again, speaking of Mr. McAllister's bill yesterday, I expressed my concern about the lack of accountability for ministers where there are perceived breaches of the Code of Conduct for ministers. There is no formal mechanism to have that investigated, and so too that extension to SPADs. Again, these are people paid by the public purse, and the public should rightly expect and do expect that there is transparency and accountability. And unfortunately, in the case which Mr. Alistair referred to, that accountability wasn't there. Accountability to your own party and to your own minister is not sufficient. There must be independent investigation and adjudication, and I think in that regard this element of the bill is very much welcome. We cannot in this Assembly set the standards for society but somehow expect those standards not to apply to ourselves. Certainly as an MLA, I'm subject to the Code of Conduct, I'm subject to independent investigation. The same should be true for ministers, and the same should be true for their special advisors. The cap and pay, I think again the member, the sponsor of the bill will find much sympathy with that and the wider public. And I'm worried that when it comes to salaries, that somehow there's always an attack on high pay, and we have to look whether or not it's justified. But a pay cap of £75,000 is certainly not to make victims of special advisers. I think that's a fair cap. Mr. Alistair has made reference to other jurisdictions and the salaries paid there, and I don't think there's an argument to be made that somehow special advisers are required to work at a higher level than other jurisdictions, or that their job is somehow more onerous. I think we can and should take evidence from elsewhere and take that evidence and base our salaries here on the findings of that. The number of spads within OFM, DFM, and reference has been made. Mr. Alistair said he's not wedded to this formula, and others have said there maybe needs to be more flexibility in the committee stage. Should this pass today, and I hope it will, can take time to tease those issues out. But it does seem to me to be hard to justify 8 spads within the Office of First and Deputy First Minister. Yes, the nature of that role, we don't have one, we have 2. Joint ministers, as Mr. McAllister pointed out yesterday, and the junior ministers that go with that, but to justify a total of 8 seems difficult in my view. So whilst 4 seems to me a sensible proposal, others seem to think there needs to be more flexibility, and we do need to, of course, have regard to the proposed changes in the number of departments and the structures of the Assembly. But under our current structures, a reduction from 8 to 4 certainly seems a worthwhile proposal to consider, and I look forward to seeing what evidence comes out during the committee stage. The one aspect, my disappointment with this bill, it is obviously the special second private member's bill on special advisers that has come forward from Mr. Alistair. And I made the point with his first bill, and I'll make it again, is the recruitment of special advisers. Many have made the point that these people are appointed by ministers. And that appointment process, I think, is one should be examined as part of the scrutiny of this bill. And bringing to line the pay and the code of conduct with those of senior civil servants, I think also the method of recruitment needs to be brought into line with that of senior civil servants. And I made this point during the passage of the previous SPAD bill. And Mr. Wilson, and I, no one's sadder than me that Mr. Wilson is no longer a member of this House, Mr. Sammy Wilson, somehow made an argument that, well, no, this is politics. You can't recruit people from outside. You couldn't possibly have a DUP SPAD who wasn't a member of the DUP. And this type of attitude feeds into the perception that I think is out there, that the political class believes itself to be a class apart, that somehow what we do is so different from any other profession that it's right that we should be able to get around recruitment rules and legislation, that we can have something different for ourselves, because we are different. What we do is different here. We run government, and that's special. But I question that logic. There are many professions that require secrecy, that require staff to have access to confidential information, whether it be workers in the health service with access to people's medical records, whether it be people within the justice system with access to criminal records, whether it be those working in banks, access to people's financial records. There are processes in place to ensure confidentiality and to ensure propriety and probity. And I think whilst those would be required in any special advisers recruited, I do not think there's an argument to say that this cannot be done with openness, transparency and accountability. And I use my own recruitment of staff as an example. I openly recruit and have recruited a number of staff from outside of the pool of Green Party membership. The nature of the work, many of them then become members of the party. But I see no reason, if I'm recruiting a researcher, why that researcher has to be a member of the Green Party. And equally, I see no reason why special advisers should be appointed solely from within the pool of that political party and appointed without interview, without merit criteria set. I think, and without that being done transparently, because possibly ministers do that, I don't know. Possibly they do when they're appointing, set the criteria of who they look for, but it's not transparent, and it is public money that's being used to pay the wages of special advisers. It is a public role. It is to serve the public good through advising the minister in terms of public policy. So I think we should have an open, transparent and accountable process, and that the recruitment of special advisers should be brought in line with that as other civil servants. They've been referred to as temporary civil servants. Well, even in temporary recruitment for civil servants posts, a recruitment process is required. And I would certainly be interested in the member's views if that's something he's considered, and would urge the committee when looking at this to look at that aspect of special advisers' employment. Thank you.
Well, Mr. John McAllister.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I'd like to begin by congratulating Mr. Allister on getting to this stage. And certainly looks as if it will get through this on the broad principles. There is agreement certainly with various parts of the bill from various political parties. I think the key parts of the bill, Principal Deputy Speaker, around the disciplinary code being applied when people are temporary civil servants, I think that's important. It's important to set a standard. It's important to have something to measure that standard that we would expect of others. So why wouldn't it apply to SPADs? So of course that. Around the issue of pay, I have to say, if I'm correct from the committee last week, it's actually 78,000 of a salary. Bear in mind that's what 30,000 more than MLAs get paid. It's not exactly, and probably close to at least four times the average salary in Northern Ireland. We're not exactly, and the member proposing this is not exactly restricting SPADs to sort of a life of destitution. So it's not. At 78,000, I would have thought he was setting the bar fairly high, and a decent balance between attracting people that we need in to jobs and that specialist role that a special advisor should fulfil, and putting a cap. The very fact that average salaries in Northern Ireland are lower than our other constituent parts of the nation makes you wonder how on earth our settlement costs us per average per head £30,500 more than Scotland and a staggering £45,000 per head more than Wales. Those are the difficulties that this bill seeks to address, that we look in a time of austerity, in a time when departments are struggling for cash, in a time when many departments are not entirely sure of what their agreed budget line is at this stage of the financial year. Yet, on the terms of SPADs, we are spending significantly more than our Scottish and Welsh counterparts, which are, for direct comparison, are easy because they are devolved governments. Now, this may be a more powerful institution than the Welsh Assembly government. May have more powers to do that. It does, of course, have a coalition form of government. But so had the Scottish and Welsh. The Scottish had, from 1999 to 2007, a Lib Dem Labour coalition and the several first ministers at that time. The Welsh have had over the time the mix between the Labour Lib Dem and Labour Plaid Cymru coalition. So this idea that somehow there's a huge problem of negotiating between the SPADs, and therefore we need extra SPADs and we need huge numbers of SPADs and they need to be so highly paid, I think it's difficult to prove much evidence of that. It's also difficult to maintain that argument when you look and have the First Minister describing the executive as dysfunctional. It's hard to say, well, the SPADs, actually increasing your number of SPADs or having so many SPADs and paying them $92,000 a year is adding much to that functionality. I would say, now, Mr. Lyons is not in his place, but in his contribution he talked about lauding the DUP, and I welcome them actually to the debate. The fact that the farm lobby and Mr. Alistair are the only two groupings so far that can actually get them to this debate sets the bar quite high. But the very fact that Mr. Lyons was making the argument about, yes, we agree with parts of this, but we're doing it anyway, and actually this bill, the timing's all wrong, and we should wait on the reduction of government departments, which is going to deliver three less SPADs anyway. Well, I warned last week, Principal Deputy Speaker, at the committee that we were to get rid of the Department of Employment and Learning sometime in the autumn of 2011. And then it came up that, well, a better time to do it would be at the end of the financial year, and then it's still here, and it's likely to hear for the rest of the mandate by the looks of it. So therefore it has survived all of this. So this idea of sort of promise of jam tomorrow from Mr. Lyons that, oh well, look, we're taking care of all this. And as Mr. Agnew said, at least this corner is producing some legislation that can actually change and reform and, in this case, restrict excessive expenditure of government on itself. So the idea that it's going to be reduced, I am supportive, as I made clear the committee, of the reform to moving to an executive office, moving to a reduced number of departments. I also think, and have made it clear on previous occasions, that certainly when you take the departmental responsibilities out of OFM, DFM, and move it much more to a coordinating body, the need for eight SPADs in it, and indeed the need for two junior ministers might be much better served being in places like a junior minister with responsibility for social care, a junior minister with responsibility for skills in the Department of the Economy. That would be a much better place for them to go and a much better practice. And certainly if you follow that logic through, that junior ministers would be an unnecessary addition in a future executive office, you would find it very, very difficult to say why on earth you would have eight SPADs in it. So I not only think Mr. Alistair is onto something with the bill, I think his timing is right as we look about not only reforming government and the size of government departments, the number of special advisers, indeed my own bill on reforming the way the executive and assembly carries out its business. So I think the bill is timely like that. I would also add that, and Ms. Cochrane mentioned it in her contribution, around this idea about skills and what skill set particular advisers are bringing in. Mr. Agnew talked about it with his own recruitment processes, and certainly any time I've recruited staff in the last number of years, or I went outside more narrow bounds and went down that road of a more open contest to recruit people. Now, for special advisers, I think as well as just being more open, I think the very fact that there is some evidence that a special advisor possesses that the skill set necessary to advise in the Department of Finance, in the Department of Health, in the Department of Social Development, in the Department of Regional Development, instead of just, as the perception sometimes is, that it looks as if it's more, oh well, it's you know, we better bring Joe in, it's his turn to do special advisor for a while. Too much of that, and it is not a good image for government to have and for this assembly to have. And that's something that I think Mr. Alistair's bill can and should be used to address. And the great thing about passing through second stage and going to committee, that leaves it not only for the committee but also for members to look at amending and changing and possibly improving some of the bill or addressing some of the concerns that they have about the bill. But certainly, Principal Deputy Speaker, I support the bill's passage through second stage.
The Business Committee has arranged to meet at 1 p.m. today. I propose, therefore, by leave of the Assembly, to adjourn to suspend the sitting until 2 p.m. The first item of business will then be question time.
Members, we now return to the second stage debate on the Civil Service Special Advisors Amendment Bill, and I call Mr. Jim Alistair to wind on the debate. Mr. Alistair.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I'm grateful to those members who contributed to this debate. Some significant and constructive points were made, and I want to acknowledge that. My starting point with this bill is not to suggest for 1 minute that it has all the answers, that it's not capable of improvement. I don't think any bill is ever in that category. And I think those members who raised issues about the need to widen the bill to include matters such as the qualifications of a special advisor were making useful points, and some others in the same vein. It is clear, however, because of a Sinn Féin U-turn and an obvious deal which they have done with the DUP, that the cabal which controls this House has determined today to kill this bill. I say Sinn Féin U-turn because when I was invited to the DFP committee last Wednesday, it was abundantly clear from the contributions made by the Sinn Féin member, Mr. O'Muir, at that committee, that he and his party appeared to be in support of the principles of the bill. He did caution that he expected that my former colleagues may halt the progress of the bill, and I think he was suggesting there might have been a petition of concern, but they didn't need it, because Sinn Féin has ridden to the rescue, it seems, and has done a deal with the DUP on this. And despite Mr. O'Muir, who wasn't here today significantly, perhaps out of the embarrassment of the U-turn that has been done, it was clear from what he was saying there that the bill was likely to meet with his and their support. But be that as it may, that deal has now become part of the sticking plaster, no doubt, that's been utilised to stick together that which is necessary to cause these institutions to limp along a little bit further until the next crisis. It would appear that some arrangement of vested interest has been made in that regard. And of course, it is the vested interest of both parties to protect the very special, unwarranted treatment that the current arrangements provide for their parties. Take Sinn Féin, for example. They tell us that their special advisers don't benefit from the full salary. The full salary is taken, But the balance of whatever is above whatever the current threshold is for Sinn Féin members is donated, it is claimed, to the party. So it's in the interests of Sinn Féin to continue to take from the taxpayer the tens of thousands of pounds that come to the coffers of their party through having a surplus of special advisers and overpaying them up to the level that they are paid. So when Sinn Féin join with the DUP, they are joining in that same vested interest, because those two parties between them now have entitlement to 16 of the 19 special advisers. And in consequence of Sinn Féin's position, of course, as I've said, that means tens of thousands of pounds every year into the coffers of Sinn Féin. DUP, of course, are in the business of protecting the useful vehicles that special advisers are for reward within the party and for maintaining that golden circle of special advisers who, given the quality of some ministers, I suppose, are indispensable in terms of running departments. But they are very much in the business of self-interest. And it is that vested self-interest of those two parties that appears today to be going to unite them to go through the no lobby so that they can continue the squander at a level wholly out of kilter with expenditure and special advisers anywhere else in the United Kingdom, so that we can continue the squander of having in one department the same number of special advisers as the whole of the Welsh Government has, so that we can continue to make special advisers exempt from discipline, such as we scandalously and shamelessly saw in respect of the Red Sky Inquiry, when the appointing minister was able to throw a human shield around the offending special advisor whom independent fact-finding had found should face a disciplinary proceedings, and the minister was able to protect him from that. So well dare anyone, such as in this bill, suggest that though we pay them as civil servants, pension them as civil servants, cosset them as civil servants, that we should dare subject them to the discipline of civil servants, and that we should dare remove from the minister that right to protect his own, as he so shamelessly did in the case of Mr. Brimstone. And it is that utterly unashamed defence of the indefensible in protect of their protection of the vested interest that they have that the DUP will vote no, and Sinn Féin, as part of some deal with the DUP, will vote no today. Now, of course, Mr. McCartney dressed it up in the most threadbare clothes imaginable. He said that Sinn Féin were going to vote against this bill because this bill was an amendment to my last bill, and they were against my last bill, therefore they must be against this bill. Such absolutely illogical nonsense. But that's the point they were driven to in their U-turn from Mr. O'Mealyer's position of last week. But this debate did do one thing. It did provoke a DUP contribution, underscoring the vested interest point. Oh yes, this House can debate health, and the DUP sits silent. This House can debate waiting lists, and the DUP sits silent. This House can debate cancer, and the DUP sits silent. Let this House debate daring to bring some financial restraint to the squander of special advisers, or dare to curb the number of special advisers, or dare to think that those civil servants should be subject to discipline. And it's business as usual for the DUP, back to protecting their own vested interest. That's what we saw today when they sent in an MLA to oppose this bill. Maybe, of course, maybe that was part of the sticking plaster deal with Sinn Féin. Maybe Sinn Féin said, well, if we're going to help you out, if we're going to save your spads, then you're going to have to put a face on it, and we're going to make you break your boycott, and we're going to make you speak in this debate. Maybe that was a little down payment from the DUP to Sinn Féin for whatever else the payoff is. Who knows? For the machinations of all of that are all but imponderable. But the plain truth is, and let the watching public remember, that when this House had the opportunity, in a time of austerity, at a time when other public servants are expected to tighten their belt, when this House had an opportunity to take the axe to the squander of OFM, DFM, having the same number of SPADs as the whole Welsh Government, had the opportunity to take the axe to the indefensible position that a SPAD in Northern Ireland costs £106,000 a year and costs £60,000 in Wales. The fact that even in a proper government, the Westminster government, they only cost £83,000 a year, but here they cost £106,000 a year. When the watching public asked the question, why was Stormont not prepared to do something about it, let them get the very clear answer that the vested interests of the two parties, Sinn Féin and the DUP, circled the wagons to protect their own. And that is apparently going to be the outcome of this debate. I made mention of the DUP breaking their boycott, returning to business as usual to protect their own. That caused an interesting little exchange on social media. Someone tweeted, DUP couldn't show up for the health debate, but they are on their feet to defend salaries of their SPADs. And in a moment of forgetfulness, one of their own MLAs retweeted it and favoured it. Mr. Gordon Dunn, until the thought police got to him and he deleted it, retweeted, DUP couldn't show up for health debate, but they're on their feet to defend salaries of their SPADs. Pity he didn't have the courage of his convictions. And of course he won't have the courage of his convictions today, because he'll meekly trip through the no lobby to protect the vested interests that are dictating this debate. Mr. Speaker, I do believe this bill was addressing a serious subject in a serious manner, in a measured manner, in a way that it required to be addressed, because we can't go on asking for public credibility if within the confines of this House we demonstrate such gross, appalling irresponsibility that we think that which is preached to others should never apply here. and that we should just continue to squander. Why not? DUP and Sinn Féin say, let us continue with all this surplus of special advisers paid for out of the public purse. Why not, they say, continue to overpay them? And why not cocoon them from basic disciplinary proceedings? It is as barefaced and shameful a defence of self-interest as anyone will see when those who walk through the no lobby do that shortly.
Thank you. And the question is that the second stage of the Civil Service Special Advisers Amendment be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Aye.
Clear the lobbies and the question will be put in 3 minutes. Order of members, resume their seats. Order. Thank you. Order. Members, resume their seats. And the question is that the second stage of the bill be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
I think the noes have it. Do we have tellers?
Thank you.
Order, members. Order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes, Mr. Basil McRae and Mr. Jim Allister. Tellers for the noes, Mr. Raymond McCartney and Mr. George Robinson. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Order. Clerk, read the result.
85 members voted, 33 members voted aye, 52 members voted no. The bill falls.
So the second stage of the Civil Service Special Advisors Amendment Bill is not agreed. The bill falls. The next item...